Today and welcome to our online service. Today we're going to continue with our Advent series, and in a moment we're going to sing together, and that can be sometimes a little bit different in our living rooms or in our offices or wherever we're watching from today. But I really want to encourage you, engage in the worship. Allow the words of the songs that are sung, allow them to take hold in your life, in your heart, and as you sing and as you join in, allow the Holy Spirit just to come and speak with you today. I'm going to read some verses from Isaiah this morning, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 28, and it says this: "Have you never heard? Have you never understood? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of all the earth. He never grows weak or weary. No one can measure the depths of his understanding. He gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. Even youths will become tired and weak, and young men will fall in exhaustion. But those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint." And I don't know how you're feeling this morning. Maybe you feel quite weak. Maybe you're feeling exhausted with the season. Maybe you're tired of just the way things are happening in our world at this point in time. But this morning, I don't want you to dwell on how you're feeling. I want you to know who it is that you can look to for the answer this morning. Verse 31 gives us the answer. It says this: but those who hope in the Lord, but those who trust in the Lord, those whose faith is in the Lord. And what does that simply mean this morning? Well, it means this, Life Church. It means that those people who come with a confident expectation of all that God has promised for them, those whose hope is in the Lord, He will renew their strength. And so this morning, as I pray, if you're feeling like your hope is low, if you're feeling like you're weak and your strength has disappeared, this morning, focus on Him, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and let your strength be renewed. So as you're watching in your home, as you're watching in your bedroom today, just remember that God has His eyes upon you. He has His eyes upon you, and He has a word for you today. So right now, just open up your heart. Allow your mind just to let go of the stuff that might hinder you today, and just say, God, speak to me. Lord, renew my strength for today. I choose to fix my eyes on You, the author and finisher. Lord, today we choose to hear the word that You have for us. Lord, I pray for every single person who is tuned in online. Lord, from those from Goulburn, Lord, from Latchford, from Lym, from West Warrington, from Cinnamon Brow. Father God, Lord, and those visitors who are tuning in today, Lord, we choose, Lord, to fix our eyes on you and say, God, renew our strength for this day. May our hope be strong in you. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Have a great service, everyone.
Gave the sign about to babe on bended knee, the Savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, we shall reign forevermore. No.
In the land of Israel, there was a young woman named Mary and a man named Joseph. Joseph was a carpenter by trade, and he loved Mary. The two were engaged to be married. They weren't rich or powerful, but they were righteous and obedient people, and God had a very special plan for them. One day, an angel came to Mary to tell her about God's plan. "The Lord is with you, Mary," he said. "You have favor with God, and you will have a baby boy. His name will be Jesus. He will be great, and will be called the Son of the Most High. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and there will be no end to his kingdom." The angel assured her that the baby would be conceived by the Holy Spirit and not by her soon-to-be husband, Joseph. When the angel left, Mary could hardly believe what had just happened. The Messiah would be born to her? She would be the one? This was the most amazing news. But there was a problem. Mary was going to have a baby, even though she and Joseph weren't yet married. What would people think? Joseph became very worried. After all, he was a man who always tried to do the right thing. He was afraid that he might have to end his engagement to Mary. But one night, God gave Joseph a dream. In the dream, an angel spoke to him and said, "Don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife. The baby in Mary is a miracle from God. She will have a son, and you shall call him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." But there was another problem. The emperor of the land, Caesar Augustus, sent out a law that everyone should be counted in the international census. Every single citizen was required to go to their hometown, and that included Joseph and Mary. Their hometown was Bethlehem, and even though Mary's due date was soon approaching, they began the long and difficult journey to Bethlehem. Mile after mile they traveled. It was very uncomfortable for Mary as her labor pains grew more intense. She was happy that she would be delivering a baby boy, none other than Jesus. But things were hard. She was on a long journey, and she knew that the baby was going to come any minute. When they finally arrived in Bethlehem, there was no place for them to stay. All the hotels and houses were filled up. They couldn't find a single room, not even for a mother who was about to have a baby. There was only one place left, a barn for animals. There in that stable, surrounded by the animals, the Savior of the world was born. They took Jesus, wrapped him warmly in cloths, and used a manger as his bed. One day, this little baby boy would hang on the cross for the sin of all mankind. That night, in the cool, dark fields surrounding Bethlehem, there was a group of shepherds taking care of their sheep. An angel appeared in the sky and announced, "I bring you good news of great joy for everyone. Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Then a whole choir of bright angels lit up the night sky and sang a beautiful song. Immediately, the shepherds went into Bethlehem and worshiped Jesus. Thousands of miles away, in the foreign lands of the East, a group of wise men heard about the news of Jesus' birth too. They followed a star. The bright star led them to the land of Israel. They knew that a king was going to be born, so they went to the leader, Herod. "We have come from the east to worship the one who has been born king of the Jews." Herod was concerned. He hadn't heard of this. "A king? But I'm the king." Sure enough, there was a prophecy. This was the Messiah, promised thousands of years before. Herod told the wise men to find this king and then bring the news back to him so he could worship the king too. But Herod didn't want to worship the king. He wanted to kill him. The wise men left Herod's palace and saw the star moving again. This time, it led them right to the house of Mary and Joseph in Bethlehem. There they met the young child, growing up in the home of the carpenter and his wife. They worshipped him and brought him beautiful gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. All gifts fit for a king. God warned the wise men in a dream that they should not tell Herod where to find Jesus. So the wise men returned home a different way. Jesus' birth was the fulfillment of many old prophecies. His life, death, and resurrection would become the cornerstone of our faith. the world would never be the same.
My desire, oh Lord, this is
Hi. I know that we are in Advent as a season, but it's important to remember that Jesus didn't come to stay a baby in the manger. He came to live, to die, and then to rise again from the dead so that we can have our sins forgiven, so that we can have eternal life, so that we can be connected to the Father. And so even as we celebrate Advent, it's always good to break bread and to drink juice to remember what he did for us. And in fact, I'd go so far as to suggest that even if you haven't planned it or you've never done it before, why don't you take some time over this Christmas season while you're at home with your families to break bread together, to remember that as great a season as Christmas is, it's just good to remember that Jesus didn't stay in the manger, that he grew up to die on the cross for our sins. So the word says this in 1 Corinthians, it says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, broken for you.'" Let's take the bread and remember that his body was broken for us. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this whenever you drink in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Jesus, we thank you for your body broken for us. We thank you for your blood shed for us. And we thank you that in this incredible season, we can remember where you were headed. Thank you for what you did on our behalf. Amen.
There are a few things we want to just bring your attention to right now, things that are happening over the Christmas period. So the first thing is that this Wednesday, the 16th, we are going to be having a special one-off Christmas Logos. And Dave Akerman is bringing us a series called Myth Busting Christmas. Now, I don't know about you, but there are certain things that I've always kind of thought were in the Christmas story. Well, chatting to Dave earlier, apparently there are some things that aren't. So if you'd like to find out what things are we kind of celebrating or do we kind of think about when we come to Christmas time that aren't actually in the Bible, then jump onto that Logos session, 8 p.m. on Zoom on the 16th of December. If you want to know the details for that, you can contact us at office@lifewarrington.com. The second thing we've got is next Sunday is our brilliant online Christmas carol service. And this is going to be a morning full of readings and carols that you can enjoy in your own home. But not only that, why don't you invite some neighbours, some friends, some family to watch it with you? You can send the link out to them if you send them lifechurchchristmas.com and invite them from their own home to view the carol service with you. And that's going to be a great, fun-filled morning for us all together. And then on the 27th, Sunday the 27th of December, we aren't having an online service that day. But what we are doing, we're going to have a special family Christmas quiz night. So again, you can join with some friends for that, or maybe people in your bubble that night, you can get together and join online, or you can join with friends over WhatsApp or over messaging together and have a team. There will be prizes, the first, the second, the 10th, the 20th, and second from last. So there's opportunities for everyone to win a prize. We will do that on Zoom, 6 o'clock on the 27th of December. And then finally, on Sunday the 3rd of January 2021 at 10:30 we will have our special online New Year's service. And on that morning, Lucas Dewhurst, he will bring to us a message for our church to take us into 2021. And we're going to launch a special 21 days of prayer that will begin from that weekend. So please remember to join in with us that day, because it will be a way that we can join together as a whole church and just hear what God has for us and things he wants us to step into.
Church, good morning. We are in the final week of our Advent series. So for the past 3 weeks, we've been looking at stories of people in the Advent story and our Christmas story. And today we're going to be focusing on the story of Mary and God's call to her. So when I started planning this sermon, I was looking up, what does Advent mean? What is a definition for Advent? And what I found is a coming into place, a coming into view, a coming into being, an arrival. So, what does Advent, that definition of Advent, what does that mean for Mary? I want to take you back a little bit to tell you some context about who Mary was before all of this started. So Mary was a young Jewish girl. She was about 12 to 14 around that time. She had just become of age to get married. I know it's crazy, but in her Jewish culture, she was engaged and betrothed to a man named Joseph. She lived in a town, a really small town named Nazareth. Now, Nazareth was in a basin surrounded by hills. There were no roads that went through it. You had to go to Nazareth if you were wanting to go to it. By that I mean you are not passing through. If you wanted to go there, that is where you were gonna go. That was kind of your dead end. That feels a little bit like when Dell and I go to Grimsby for visiting. We are going east on the M180, and then all of a sudden I look around and all the lorries are disappearing and it's just us. There's one way in and one way out. It's a little bit like Grimsby. Sorry, Del. Now, Mary grew up devoted to God, devoted to Jewish law and customs. She and her family and her people were under Roman rule, so it was pretty tough during those times. It is believed that she immersed herself in the teachings of the prophets of the Old Testament and even the Psalms. And her people, the people who were devoted to God, were waiting together collectively for their Messiah. They're waiting and hoping and praying. They're believing in the unseen, and they believe that because God said he would rescue his people, that he would. So one of those texts that I believe she knew to highlight what they were waiting for, something that they read, was Isaiah 9, 6 through 7. And this says, "For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this." So this prophecy of Isaiah was written 700 years before the time of Mary. So in the community she was in, of course they believed it. But wouldn't you think day after day, week after week, year after year, generation after generation, they might get a little bit weary of looking over their shoulder. Is it gonna happen? I'm sure that they had the faith, but sometimes you get a little bit into your ordinary life and life goes on. And you don't know when and you don't know how, but maybe their belief dimmed a bit too. But one day, everything changed, and probably in a way that they didn't expect. So let's go and read Luke 1, 26 through 38. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be," Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin?" The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who is said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month, for no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. Now this was huge news for Mary, for her people. I can't even imagine how shocked Mary was that the fact that an angel came to visit her, the words that the angel said, I'm sure were reeling in her mind, and also just how humble she must have felt. This small city in the scope of the world, an ordinary girl, God would choose her to play this part in the story of his rescue and redemption. So I want to take a look. I think it'd be interesting to take a look at the ways that Mary reacts to this call from God. First of all, Mary responds in wonder. So when Gabriel speaks to her, of course she has probably a million questions in her mind, and she asks one. And it seems a little familiar because a few weeks back when we were learning about Zechariah, he asks a question too. And both questions, I think if you were to put them right next to each other, could look very identical. Zechariah says, "Well, how can I be sure that this will even happen? I'm old, my wife is old." And Mary asks the question to Gabriel too. "Well, how can this be since I am a virgin?" I think that there is something different between these two. Obviously, we know after learning that Zechariah gets rebuked by Gabriel. He said something wrong. And Mary, when she asks a question, she is given more information from Gabriel about what will happen and how it will happen. So we weren't there. We don't know how they asked the question, their attitude, their inflection. You know, a lot can be said in that. But I think because we know the results of those questions, that we can probably gather that Zechariah was asking his question out of disbelief, out of doubt, fear, insecurity, and maybe a little control. And Mary was asking out of curiosity, wonder, and awe. "I can't even imagine how this could happen." It is taking her out of it, and it is saying, "Oh God, this is so big, this is so much bigger than me." And I think her awe, her curiosity, her childlike faith even, was honoring to God. So when God calls us, when he asks us something, what is our attitude? What kind of questions do we ask? Do we hesitate in insecurity? "No, I could not be the one. I am not the one you need, the one you want. You disqualify yourself before you even start." Or even in your confusion of how it's possible, you lean into the possibility that even though you don't know, you believe that God can accomplish it. I think that's a challenge for all of us and for me too. So that's the first thing. Mary responds in wonder. So the second way Mary reacts to this call is she obeys in faith. So we see in verse 38, she basically says to the Lord through Gabriel, "May your word to me be fulfilled." This was giving her submission to the will of God. But what happens is, after that moment, I believe that the journey of faith really gets activated after that. Because then she has to walk out to what she has said. She's submitted, but now she's got to follow step by step in obedience. So what we see is, not only does she have to absorb it and believe it for herself, but she has to tell Joseph. She has to be truthful with her family, with her community, and at the risk of shame and condemnation. Joseph's brought into this process because he has to obey the call of God, because he also gets notified of this as well through a dream. And then after this, even after Jesus is born, this family only moves when the Holy Spirit, or when God, tells them to go. All for their protection, all for their good, all for God's glory. Move after move after move, step after step, faith is being exercised. And they are so sensitive to that. Mary continues on to raise Jesus into adulthood, yielding to God's guidance. I can't even imagine what must be going through her head. I have to raise the Messiah. That's not something that she can do on her own. She has to submit and obey in faith all along the way. To obey the Lord's voice with such sensitivity is what I have found to be a result of full surrender to the Holy Spirit and the work that he does, not only once, but over and over and over. And that leads us to the third reaction for Mary. She invites the Holy Spirit to work in and through her. Again, in verse 38, so Luke 1, 38, she consents to whatever God has for her, whatever he wants in and through her. In verse 35, we see that God would deliver a son to her womb by his power and through his Spirit. This is the same Spirit that speaks creation into existence, the same Spirit that brings us life in our lungs, the same Spirit that draws us to Jesus, to knowing we need him, and unites us with the Father. This is the Spirit of God. Mary was filled to the brim with the Holy Spirit in such a beautiful way. And let's carry on reading the scripture, and we'll see what the Holy Spirit is doing in Mary. So let's go back to Luke 1. I'm going to set the scene again a little bit. So as soon as she hears from Gabriel, she runs over to another town in the hills to visit her relative Elizabeth, which we've heard about. And Elizabeth had been hearing from the Holy Spirit herself, because she knew instantly when Mary came what was happening. And this is what Elizabeth says in verse 42. "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her." And we'll carry on with what Mary said. "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name." And her song continues with prophesying and echoing the prophecies of old of everything that the Messiah, her child, would do for his people, and that he would reign over all and his kingdom would never end. So both Mary and Elizabeth were not only basking in the glow of pregnancy, but they were basking in the splendor and the glory of the Holy Spirit doing a work in their lives. They were the fullness of pregnant expectancy. And I know that sounds kind of like a buzzword, and it is a buzzword, but think about it. Pregnant expectancy. You know that something is going to happen. You are in the fullness of it. You can almost see it, but it's not yet. But you're acting as though it is. And what is that for us? Is there something that we are full of that no one else can see, but we know deep in our hearts, whether it's a promise from God, a dream, a scripture fulfilled? They are a great example, being full of the Spirit, surrendering to the Spirit so that he can give them and us a vision of what is to come, even if no one else sees it. So Advent, a coming into place, a coming into view, a coming into being, an arrival. What is Advent for us? We know that Jesus has come. We've experienced it. Hopefully you have too. And we have received that salvation, the gospel of who Jesus is. I believe that through this Advent season, God is wanting to bring us into new things. He's wanting those new things to come into view, like the definition says. Maybe things we've forgotten about or have decided in disbelief that they won't happen, that they're not going to happen for us. Have you been carrying an idea, a dream, a project, a plan, a vision, or maybe not even that? Maybe a whisper in your heart of a truth about who you are. Have you been carrying those things that you haven't seen yet? Or maybe you've seen them, and like Mary and Joseph, you're just walking step by step in faith, and that journey can get long, and you want to obey, and sometimes it's difficult. We can learn a lot from how Mary reacted to the call. Mary asks the question, and we can too. Things of God are so much bigger than we can think of or imagine. We can only just say, how can this even be? But saying that is acknowledging that we are fully dependent upon God and it cannot happen without Him. To ask, how can I be sure that this will happen? You know, that's taking the burden on ourselves to make it come to pass. And God didn't intend for that. When we ask good questions and we rely on Him, we honor Him, we trust in His timing, and we know that He'll do what He says He's going to do. Also, Mary surrendered to the work of the Holy Spirit in and through her. She had a perfect openness to anything the Holy Spirit wanted to do, both at the moment of her calling and each step of the way. It just doesn't stop at the beginning. It carries on and carries on, and the journey is better than the destination. I know that that is controversial, but it is. That's where the growing happens. That's where we come into being, like the definition says. It's not only about what God has us to do, but who He's making us to be. We don't want to waste that process either. Are there areas in your life that you're maybe holding too tightly to? Whether it's disbelief, insecurity, whether it's, I'm going to make this happen. I think that one of the most unnatural things is to open up our hands and let it go and surrender to see what God does with it. But I think that's what He's wanting from us. The truth is, by yielding to Him, we're giving Him permission to accomplish what He set out to do in the first place. He wants to do it, and He wants to do it through us, but we need to let Him have it. Also, I believe that there's a lot of this world who are still waiting for the advent of their Messiah, their wonderful Counselor, their mighty God, their everlasting Father, and their Prince of Peace. And they may or may not know that. How is God calling you to reach your community? Is it in your workplace? Is it talking to your neighbor? Is it engaging with your friends and family? Is it coming up with a project or an idea? We can talk about the calling that God has, but our first calling and the calling for all believers is to be a witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Mary was a literal carrier of the gospel, mind, spirit, body. She carried the gospel. She said yes to her part in God's grand love story for humankind. The work of Jesus was foretold in Ezekiel. Ezekiel 34, verses 11 and 12 says, "For this is what the sovereign Lord says, I myself will search for my sheep and look after them. As a shepherd looks after his scattered flock when he is with them, so will I look after my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places where they were scattered on a day of clouds and darkness." And then we see Jesus come to earth, and in Luke 15, he talks about the parable of the lost sheep and how wonderful it is and how much of a celebration it is when one turns around and comes home. And then we also see in Luke 19:10, Jesus says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." And then finally, Jesus prays this prayer for himself. And I want to pray this prayer. And I hope you want to pray this prayer too. In John 17, 4, it says, I have brought you glory, Jesus speaking to God, I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. The world needs to hear about the advent of Jesus. Advent, a coming into view, a coming into being, a coming into place. Let's pray. Thank you so much for the gift of your son, Jesus. Thank you that you sent him to the world to live, to die as a perfect sacrifice for all of our sins, and that you sent the Holy Spirit to lead and to guide us. No matter what you ask of us, Lord, prepare our hearts to have courage and submission to say yes to you. We want our lives to be sharers of the gospel, not only with our words, but our actions and everything we set our hands to do. Thank you that you choose us in your great love story for humanity. And I pray that so many people would realize the advent, just like Mary experienced it so many years ago, that we would know what it is to have a new advent this season, a coming into view and a coming into being of who you've created us to be. We thank you so much, Lord, and we give you all the honor and praise. Amen.
So thank you, Lindsay, for your word to us this morning. And church, you know, let's remember the gift that God has given us, a gift for us not just to keep to ourselves, but the gift of Jesus for us to share with our communities. I'm going to pray now. And as we finish this service, I pray God's blessing over you all this Christmas time. And may you know his joy and may you know his hope in your lives. So Father, Lord, we thank you for this past hour that we've shared together. Thank you for your goodness and your grace. Lord, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you that you gave him and you sent him, Lord, into our world. The gift of your son, Lord. Lord, I pray this Christmas time, Lord, I pray that we would not forget who it is that we've come to celebrate, who it is that has come to bring light into our world. Lord Jesus, I pray, Lord, that you will help us this Christmas to share you, to share the hope that we have in you to our friends and our families, Lord. Lord, may people see the light of you shining in our lives, Lord. May we be such a witness for you. And help us, Lord, enable every single one of us to walk in the boldness and the confidence of who you are. Pray a blessing over you, church, right now. And I pray that as you go forward into this Christmas time, that you will know the will of God for your life and he will bring people across your path who you can share the hope of Christ. Amen. Until next week's carol service, I pray you have a great week. Don't forget Logos on the 16th and we'll see you at the carol service at 10:30 online next Sunday. Have a great week, everyone.
See you.